αφήστε τώρα, το περίμενα. 99-59.
Τρία μηδενικά, το πρώτο είναι για να βγεις από το κέντρο μας.
Μάλιστα, να το βάλω το πρώτο.
Α, μήπως δεν μπορούν τα δύο.
Το 99 το δεύτερο. Αλλά αυτό...
Πώς δεν μπορούν να βγουν δύο γραμμές.
Χάι. Χάι. Χάι, how are you? Is the new semester okay?
Yeah, they took our mic away though.
Can you hear it, George?
Well, I'm going to be there next next week. I'm coming to meet human. Well, you are my friends. Human, I don't know.
Yeah.
Okay. So, what happened to the rest? I can count only four.
Michal is still not back from vacation, and we don't know what happened.
Okay. So can you hear me okay from over there?
Yeah.
All right. You have already the PowerPoint set over there so that we can start immediately because can you see the PowerPoint there?
Yeah.
Okay. Now can you see the PowerPoint also? What do you see now, me or the PowerPoint?
Oh, you.
You see me?
You.
Okay, all right. Okay.
One screen on the right, you know you have something on the right?
I have to lean on the right. Here is it with the camera. Is it better now?
On your left, actually.
It's okay.
That's fine, it's beautiful.
It's good.
Well, okay. Are we okay now?
Yeah.
Good. So, τι καταγράφεις τώρα, αυτή την εικόνα ή το...
Θέλω να καταγράψω το μέλλον, ναι, αυτούς ανάπτωτε.
Okay. Now, we're going to talk about the neuroscience course today. We're going to make a very large introduction and a rather quiet introduction. That is, you are not going to get so much information that you have to read or learn for your exam. The reason I decided to start that way is so that you have a very good idea what neuroscience is all about. I have looked at your program, and neuroscience is one of the biggest subjects that you have this semester, correct? Therefore, we are going to try to cover it in a lot of detail. We are going to do as all the hours, and I'm going to be up there to see you close enough and close by. The thing that I want to mention is that I want us to utilize the experience that we had from last semester. Now, from your exams, frankly speaking, I was a little disappointed, but I was not unhappy. I was not unhappy because it was your first semester in Bulgaria, away from home. Conditions were not right about half of the time. You had problems adjusting. You had problems putting things together. So I can understand why there was slack here and there and everywhere. On the other hand, the exam statistics, which I have sent to all of you, so that indeed you really did your best, and although there are a lot of things that remain to be prepared on, there is nothing that is of critical importance anymore. So I would suggest that as we go along, I'll keep sending you the multiple choice question sets that I have, so that you prepare yourself better all along the way, rather than leave it for the last minute, and also cover some of the ground that you left untouched in the previous semester. This is regarding physiology. Now, in terms of neuroscience, we are going to go from the beginning with me bombarding you with a lot of multiple choice questions. You don't have to do all of them all the time, but at least you'll have sufficient amount so that whenever you have time, you can go back to them and keep training yourselves. We are going to do two quizzes, a midterm and a final this time. We're not going to leave everything for the week before last when we did the midterm and the final. This time we're going to do it on time. Okay? We agree on that? Okay. The next thing I want to ask you, and I really need your agreement, is that you are going to not complain when you get the avalanche of all the questions that I'm going to be sending you. Because this is for you. This is something that you can use either now or when you are preparing for your boards. So I should not follow your advice as I did last time, which was don't bombard you with a lot of questions because you had other courses. Of course you have other courses. Do your best, okay? Do we agree on these principles? You agree? Okay. So, what is neuroscience all about? You noticed in your physiology course that we do very little about the nervous system. And we do very little about the nervous system in physiology, not because the nervous system is not part of what physiology studies, but mainly because there is so much progress going on right now and so much interest in the nervous system that in effect it's becoming an independent science. And it's not only becoming an independent science because it's giving answers to medical problems, it is giving us answers to basic technology. That is, the way we design things nowadays take the nervous system into account. You'll have probably read that there are such things as artificial neural networks. Now, what an artificial neural network is? It is a collection, either physical or virtual, of small modules that behave like neurons, or at least what we think neurons do. And if you put them together, they self-organize and they learn to do things. So instead of sitting down and trying to write programs whereby you resolve all the potential problems, by following this method, scientists have found out that they can do smart machines. So this is why neuroscience is becoming a separate science. It studies the human brain in order to also reproduce some of its functions. Okay? But we are here because we want to be medical students, or some of us are medical doctors, and so we are going to have a very medical-centered physiology neuroscience course, okay? If I slip and I say physiology, think about it as neurophysiology. It is the same, well, it's not exactly the same thing, because neuroscience covers a lot of biochemistry also and a lot of other things and neuroanatomy. But physiology plays a cardinal role in it, a crucial role. It is kind of a backbone together with molecular genetics, the backbone of neuroscience. Well, you know who I am, and you know my contact details. I'm putting them up. I'm putting the map basically because I don't want to ever miss you. Last time when things got tough, a lot of you called me, and I'm very happy that you did. And I hope that whatever I managed to do for you had some result. Still, don't think that I'm going to leave you alone this semester, because we're going to have a lot of time to spend together. There are two courses we're going to cover together. So if you need things, please call me. But call me early. Don't let things get out of control first. Okay? I can be much more helpful that way. So, I have to tell you that the idea that our soul or our body or our way of thinking or anyway our personality, if you want to put it that way, resides inside our skull is very old. In fact, Hippocrates, who is the father of ancient Greek medicine, and I'm sure that most schools, medical schools, have some kind of a statue for him, even today, insisted that from the brain and the brain only arise our pleasures, our joys, our laughter and jests, as well as our sorrows, pains, griefs, and tears. And he continued on to say that the things we suffer all come from the brain, when the brain is not healthy. Well, I ended the sentence there, because from that point on he became a little bit mystic, saying that our brain can become dry or wet, hot or cold. Well, I don't think that modern science really pays too much attention to what I have left out, because I don't think that anybody believes that the brain gets dry, but yes, it does get dehydrated in some way. Anyway, this comes from Hippocrates in his Sacred Disease treatise. So, before we start in earnest with the different items that we have to talk about, I would rather start you from a little bit historical perspective, because I think that some of the concepts that you're using today, concepts with which we are going to negotiate through the course, have a long, long history. What I'm going to try to present to you is a timeline of how neuroscience developed. And the timeline starts in 1600 and it ends in 2000, when supposedly the decade of the brain ended. We're going to talk about this in a little while. In those 400 years, I have managed to isolate 35 events that, not according to me alone, but according to most people that deal in neurosciences, they believe they are the events that change the way that we think about ourselves and our brain. Because after all, neuroscience is talking about our brain, and our brain, at least the way we look things today, our brain is ourselves. So things start about 350 years ago, a little bit more than that, in 1649, when René Descartes described the pineal body in the brain as the control center of the body and mind. I am going to stop for a second here and try to point out something for you, a general principle. The general principle is that our understanding of our brain is as good as the technology that we use at the time that we describe the brain. Now, this is not something that I was lucky enough to think, because somebody else thought about it. And the originator of this thought is Walter Freeman III, emeritus professor of neuroscience in Berkeley, California, who is probably one of the real living legends of neuroscience, and probably the most, I should say, unlucky person in neuroscience, because he should have gotten the Nobel Prize, in my opinion, at least twice, but his way of doing things and his way of thinking and his way of writing is so deep that very few people understand him. I don't claim to understand him always myself, despite the fact that I have been his student. But anyway, he not only has a very deep understanding of neuroscience, but he comes from a family of doctors that traditionally treated neural disease. His father was the infamous Walter Freeman II, who is the neurosurgeon that performed the lobotomy on the sister of President Kennedy. If you, some of you may have read, because you are too young to recall, the Kennedy family had a mentally retarded daughter who was the sister of the President Kennedy, Bobby Kennedy, and the present senator from Massachusetts, Ted Kennedy. And at some point, because she was becoming very promiscuous, her father decided that she needed treatment, and at that time they decided to lobotomize her, and the father of Walter Freeman, who gave the saying that I mentioned to you, is the person that did that lobotomy. Anyway, I mention this because when you come from such a background, normally you have a very deep understanding of what you're talking, and I take it very seriously that René Descartes described the pineal body, in our brain as the control center of the body and mind, because the technology of his time permitted him to think in these terms. What was the technology that I'm talking about? The technology was hydraulics. And at that time, the hydraulic press was already invented. And René Descartes thought that the pineal body was a very small but crucial point of our body, because that's where our soul resided. And his concept was that the soul was a little angel, no bigger than the head of a pin. And he was sitting in the pineal body in front of a lot of controls, and he was pulling levers. And of course, if you know a little bit about the technology of hydraulics, if you increase the pressure inside the pipe, you can make things move. So in his mind, the little angel, our soul, was pulling levers and made our hands to move up and down, to turn our head right and left, roll our eyeballs, and so on and so forth. It was kind of, his concept of our human being was that the brain was a command center. Inside the command center, there was this lone soul that was sitting in front of controls, and it was interacting through this outside robot, which is our body, with the world outside. Very, very important way of thinking, and don't think that today we are very far away from his concept. We are still arguing, if you look at some of the books on the philosophy of neuroscience, you'll find out that we are still arguing the mind-body problem, although now we are talking about other theories rather than hydraulics. Well, about 60 years later, there is another guy that came along, Anthony von Leeuwenhoek, who described for the first time a nerve fiber in cross-section. Now, when we did physiology in the first semester, you recall that I had shown you pictures of nerve axons covered around with a big myelin sheath. Do you recall that? Yep, this was this concentric circles running around the axon. Well, this is what Anthony von Leeuwenhoek saw at that time. And of course, nerves were already existing in the minds of people. Now, Leeuwenhoek described a single nerve fiber, but Descartes already had seen nerves, and he knew that nerves were made out of many, many parallel little fibers. And it was very natural for him to think that these were small pipes running all together in a big bundle. Well, Anthony von Leeuwenhoek probably made things easier for Descartes' ideas because he had now seen that indeed these things looked like pipes and in cross-section. And that's where things were for another 80 years almost, or 70 years, until in Italy, a guy by the name Luigi Galvani had the spent one afternoon hanging up in the dry air of the spring in Italy, hanging outside of his window, frog legs to dry. They used to take the frog legs, salt them, and hang them to dry so they could use them in the winter. You know, frog legs are considered a delicacy in many parts of the world, not only in Italy, but also in California. In fact, I first tried them in California and then in Europe, irrespective of the fact that they say that France and Italy make the best frog legs. Any one of you have tried frog legs? Okay. No such thing, right? Well, what happened is that as Luigi Galvani was tying his frog legs on a wire to dry, he noticed that if he touched it with a different type of metal, in other words, if the wire was made of one kind of metal, iron, let's say, and he touched them with copper, then the frog legs jumped. Well, Galvani was a physicist that knew that if you put two metals together, you are going to be able to have potential difference. This is because the electrons from one metal jump into the other, which is has a different density of electrons. And he had already experimented with electricity. But when he saw that, immediately he made the connection that if the frog legs, which were part of a dead body, excised, taken apart out of a dead frog, if they could move when he touched them with something that created electricity, therefore it was electricity that was the basis of all life. So he started a whole new theory that electricity was what was running inside the nerves rather than pressure, as Descartes had thought. Interesting thinking, isn't it? But then again, he was not too far away, because as you recall from basic physiology, from the initial chapters in physiology, well, we're talking now about action potentials, which is very close to the thinking of Luigi Galvani. So, from this point on, the basics of why our body is behaving the way it is, the basics, I said, was put to rest. Everybody thought that it was electricity running through nerve fibers that did things in the nervous system. So that people started paying attention to other things, more like what we're going to be doing this semester. They were thinking about questions like why we move, why we think, and how. In 1836, Mark Dax wrote a paper on the left hemisphere damage. And he said that if you have damage in your left hemisphere, you cannot speak very well. Well, this is the first time that neuroscience stops being a theoretical science and an experimental science at that, and it goes into studying the human being itself. people that had damaged brains, people that hit their head and they had a hemorrhage, for example, on the left hemisphere, they had problems with speech. Well, about the same time, following what Leeuwenhoek had established a few years earlier, and using the microscope, because as you know, Leeuwenhoek invented the microscope, another guy by the name Valentin discovered the nuclear nucleus and the nucleolus, and he really showed that nerves were nothing else but cells like every other cell in the body. And the next year, this was a very prolific decade, next year, Jan Purkinje, as we call him in the American medical schools, described the first cerebellar cell. Now, the cerebellum is a small brain underneath our brain, and it has very, very elaborate cells. If you recall, I talked to you in the previous semester about the design of a nerve cell, that it has dendrites and it has one axon. Well, the Purkinje cells have the most axons, the most dendrites that have been reported. Some of them make contact with 300,000 other cells. Okay? This is an immense number. An immense number. Okay. As I said, this was a very prolific decade, and next year, Robert Remarque suggests that the nerve cell, in other words, what 2 years before that had been described as having a nucleus and a nucleolus, a nerve cell, and a nerve fiber, what in other words we observed when we took a cut through a nerve, what Leeuwenhoek had described, were actually the same thing. In other words, the nerve fiber was attached to a nerve cell. This was the first time that people started thinking in terms of cell bodies and cell axons. Nerve bodies and nerve axons. And guess what? The next year, Theodor Schwann, who, as you recall, is the guy that described the myelin sheath that goes around the nerve axons, Theodor Schwann proposed for the first time the cell theory. That is, that the human body is made out of cells and it's not a jelly or jello, depending on what you like to, whether to, you like to play with it or you like to eat it. Okay? Excuse me? Oh, there was a, well, these days I've become very, very worried. There are earthquakes, there are tsunamis, there is noise from down below, all things together. Anyway. We saw that Robert Remarque, the year before Schwann, had described the nerve cell. Well, since Theodor Schwann stole from him the great idea of the cell theory, Robert Remarque came back, looked at the brain again, and he provided the first illustration of a six-layered cortex. Now, what do we mean by a six-layered cortex? Well, our brain is a very, very peculiar looking material. It's not very big. First of all, although we have the third largest brain in the whole animal kingdom, well, actually the fourth largest, the brain sizes go, whale is the first one with about 4.5 kilos of brain in its skull. Then comes the elephant with about 2.5 kilos. Then comes the porpoise, which has about 2 kilos. And then comes man, which has about 1 kilo and 400 grams. roughly speaking, okay? So, this material, when you look at it in the surgery room, when the time comes for you to watch some brain surgery, you'll find out that it is gray pinkish in color. And if you had the chance to put your hands on it and play with it, I hope nobody will allow you to do that. But let's say in the old times you used to do that in different experiments. If somebody allows you to touch it, it gives you the feeling of soft cheese, like the cheese that we spread in the morning, okay? Only it has this peculiar pinkish, gray pinkish color. Well, if you put that under the microscope, you find out that it has a lot of fat in it, a lot of Schwann cells or similar other cells that are very similar to Schwann cells that cover the fibers that start from its outside and go deep inside, and then the outside is covered by the cortex, so-called. That cortex, which is what we see when we take the brain in our hands, or a dead brain in our hands, that cortex covers all the outside of the brain. By the way, your brain is about as big as the size of your two fists put together. Okay, maybe a little bit larger, but that's about it. Okay. So, Robert Remarque provided the first illustration of a six-layer cortex. We're going to come back to it many times in our discussion of neuroscience. Well, about the middle of the 19th century, there was another guy by the name Augustus Waller who described for the first time how nerve fibers degenerate. In fact, we call even today the degeneration of a nerve fiber as a Wallerian degeneration. Wallerian coming from, not Waller, from Waller, which is the German way of saying his name. But that's okay. And immediately after, 5 years later, an Italian by the name of Bartolomeo Panizza showed for the first time that when we see something, the first part of our brain that responds is the occipital part, the cortex of the occipital part of our brain. Now, this is essential. We have some visitors.
They're talking really loud.
Δεν μπορεί να κάνεις τέτοια κατεβάσεις στα μπάσα, έχουν πολλά μπάσα αυτή τη στιγμή. Εντάξει, άστο. Okay, can we go on? What was that? What?
Can you be a little bit louder?
I can hear you very well.
You're speaking very loud outside.
Outside, we can't hear
Okay, I thought that there was somebody from the university that had come. Anyway, it's okay. Can you hear me well now?
Yeah.
Okay. Excellent. I hope I'm not boring you with all this history, but believe me, you're going to need some of the concepts that you're going to meet in this description. So, following Panizza, which was the first one to introduce, in effect, not only the fact that we needed our occipital cortex in order to see, but also the corollary to that the brain does not do everything with all its existence, but it has specialization within the different areas. Well, next comes Camillo Golgi, who for the first time sought a link between neuroscience and psychiatry. In other words, he said, okay, what have we been saying up to now? We have been saying that if you hit your brain on the left side, there are chances, if you sustain sufficient damage, that you cannot speak. If you hit your brain in the occipital part, if you hit the back of your head, in other words, or if your wife hits you on the head in the back part, you may end up blind. Well, all these are things that have to do with motion and understanding of the world. But Golgi decided that it was not only that, but it was our emotions that also came out of the same source, out of the body. So he tried to make the first link between neuroscience and psychiatry. Up to now, up to 1870, which is almost 150 years ago, a little bit less, all these things had to do, A, with experiments, B, with clinical observations, because I don't think that anybody hit someone over the head in order to see whether he loses his eyesight. But in 1870, people started getting back to more serious experiments. Experiments that were going to establish that not only perception resides in the brain, but also actual motor responses. So Edward Hitchcock and Gustav Fritz took a dog and they put the wires in his head and they electrocuted the area that corresponds to the motor cortex, and guess what? The dog moved its legs. So this was the first demonstration that actually motion and reaction has to start from the brain. In other words, not only this, the brain is the place where incoming sensations get processed, but this is the place where outgoing reactions are established and originate. And in 1875, Richard Caton was the first to record the electrical activity of the brain. Now, if you don't get bored with a little bit of history, I'm going to get on the board and describe to you how he did it, because it is quite interesting to think about it. Can you see the board?
Yeah.
Okay, this is it. Okay. Well, Caton took a rabbit. Okay?
Yeah. Can you use another highlighter?
Another color?
A red one or black?
I'll try a red one and you tell me if this is better.
Yeah?
Yeah? the rabbit. And what he did? He opened up a hole in his skull and exposed a part of the brain. Now, why do I use little blue color here? It's only because I told you it's gray pinkish. And then what he did, he brought an electrode here, and he also put an electrode somewhere else in the body, let's say in one of the ears. Now, this electrode here was something like a cotton swab, which was tapered at the end and filled with normal saline. Then he took a wire from here and a wire from the ear, and he brought these two things to a so-called galvanometer. What is a galvanometer? Galvanometer is a device where you have two moving, two very light pieces of metal that are close to each other. Well, you know that if you put electricity here, if you put if you let the electricity run through this thing, then these two leaves are going to spread apart, because they have the same charge here and there, and when you have the same charge, these two leaves of metal push each other away. Those leaves were made of pure gold. Why? Because pure gold is very malleable. You can really heat it and heat it and make it into a very, very big sheet of metal, and very, very thin, very light. So if you have two pieces like this and you connect them with a common wire, if you put charge here, these things are going to push one the other apart. Is that understood? Hello?
Yes.
Okay. So, Cayton reasoned that if I have a potential difference between the brain and the ear, this thing is going to show. And of course, you may have a potential difference, and this doesn't mean very much to us today, but in that time, it meant a lot. It meant that what Luigi Galvani had said about electricity was real. Well, he went one step further. He said, if this animal here can think or perceive or try to do something, and electricity is the reason for it, then the potential difference between here and the ear should change. Why? Because nobody thinks that we think with our ears. Everybody thinks that we think with our brains. Okay? So, if this thing happened, then these things should start moving up and down. In other words, a little bit out, or back in, depending on the strength of the voltage on the brain at the point where you put the electrode. Okay? Is that understood up to this point? Yeah. Now, how do you record it? Because this was the next thing, is how do you record this thing? Well, he did the following ingenious thing. He signed a beam of light here. And guess what? If you sign a beam of light, this thing is going to be reflected. And if you have your wall here, it's going to make a spot. Okay? And if this thing changes, in other words, if this gold leaf moves that way instead of where it was before, then what will happen? the angle will change and the beam of light is going to be reflected differently. So it's going to go up here. So what Caton did next is to shine the light to the rabbit's eye, and guess what happened? This spot here moved up and down. This is what we call today an evoked potential, and it was recorded with the most primitive material that you can think, okay, 130 years ago, with the most primitive material, but just as accurately. In fact, he had his students go up and down the huge wall that was in the Royal Society when he made the demonstration in England, and they painted on the wall numbers so they could decide how much the field here changed. Not only, in other words, he showed that there was electricity generated inside the brain that was the responsible for all the movement and all the perception that we have, but he managed to measure it too. So meanwhile, if you recall, the people that described the nerves and the neurons that make up the nerves were not sitting still. They're also working on their own science, and the microscopists found out that the nerve body not only gave away an axon, a fiber, but also it had a lot of little extensions sticking out of the cell body, making contact with other cells around. And this they called dendrites because they looked like trees. Dendrite means something that looks like a tree. And finally, in 1891, Wilhelm von Walderger coined the term neuron. Now we had, for the first time, a whole unit that was part of what the brain was doing. It was the building block of the brain. And that unit had dendrites, which was the part of the cell that received information, and had an axon, which was the part of the cell that transmitted information. Okay? And guess what? The 19th century ended with Albert Feuerkölliker coining the term axon. Axon means something that is narrow and long. And this is exactly how the fibers look. Why axon? Because axons normally are used to convey direction. Okay? Axon or axis, as it has been coined in English. Okay? And this is how we talk about the axis of evil, as President Bush says, that is, there is a direction of evil, or the axis between Germany and Italy in the Second War, and so on and so forth. Okay? So, the century changed, and along came the application of all these things unto human beings. There is a person, or there was, he's long time dead now, Harvey William Cushing, who was the, with capital T, the neurosurgeon. He was, in effect, one of the pioneers of neurosurgery, and he was also the person that introduced anesthesiology. Up to his days, when they wanted to do an operation, they used to give somebody about a liter of wine to drink, then they beat him on the head to knock him unconscious, and then about 15 people were holding him down while the surgeon was doing his job. The surgeon had to be very fast. So fast that during during the American Civil War, the record is that you could amputate a leg in 24 seconds. Well, once anesthesiology was invented, and don't forget the American Civil War was 1860, only 40 years before Cassing. Once anesthesiology was invented, all this brutal way of doing surgery ended. And Cassing, of course, utilizing his great academic strength, because if you invent something like anesthesiology, people look the other way when you make experiments. He was the first one to repeat the experiments of electrocuting a dog's brain by stimulating the human sensory cortex. Well, it sounds a little, and it was a little bit crude, but in effect, in the next 50 years, this was a very powerful tool in the hands of neurosurgeons. And it ended up so that in 1952, Penfield, in the Montreal Neurological Institute, by using stimulation, was able to point on the human brain both a map for receiving the somatosensory information, a map of the places where this information about our body is processed, and also a map of the places where this information turns into action. Okay? All this started with Cushing, who decided to electrocute the exposed sensory cortex of human beings. In 1906, along comes Ramón y Cajal and Camilo Golgi. We have talked about the second one. The first one is one of the greatest names, probably the greatest name in neuroanatomy. And they were both awarded the Nobel Prize on the structure and function of the nerve cells. Santiago Ramón y Cajal was the person that said that our brain is not a syncytium. Remember the heart and how the electricity runs from one cell into the other? Well, everybody thought that the same thing was happening in the brain. You had dendrites, you had axons, but they're connected at very, very small points where the cytoplasm of one cell was connected with the cytoplasm of the other. Well, Santiago Ramón y Cajal put this notion to rest forever, at least for the mammals, okay? Because in some lower invertebrates, electrical synapses do exist. 1911, another Nobel Prize about the optics of the eye. Alvar Gullstrand was able to describe how our eye works. And Robert Barani, 3 years later, he does the same thing about not our ear, but our vestibular apparatus. In other words, this is our sensor as to whether we are sitting up or down, whether we are moving or sitting, whether we are accelerating or slowing down. All this is done through the vestibular apparatus, which is residing inside your ears, and it was for the first time described by Barani, and that got him the Nobel Prize. And with all these things now fairly clear, what were these things? First, that sensory information goes to the brain, and it goes to specific areas of the brain. Motor actions coming from the brain and coming from particular areas in the brain. That the cortex was the final arbitrator of everything, because that's where everything ended and that's where everything started. And that the cortex had 6 layers. You recall that thing that I told you we were going to talk about it later? The layers of the cortex, which was invented almost 100 years before these guys? Well, all these things put together permitted the German scientist by the name of Cecil Vogt to to describe the cortex with a microscope into 200 distinct areas. Now these areas were not necessarily functionally different one from the other, but they were definitely cytoarchitectonically, that means they had different cells, different types of cells in each of these fields. Well, since then, there was another scientist who in 1930, Von Economo, who in 1930 described almost 250 cortical areas. In other words, took Cecil Voigt's work and put it forth a little bit. And then after this was done, in the 1940s, Brodmann came in, another anatomist, and combined some of these things together so we understand the brain much easier now. And there are about 50 distinct areas that we can describe not only in terms of their anatomy, but also a lot more in terms of their function today. Well, don't hold your breath. With the techniques that have come online now, and we're going to talk about them in a minute, or in an hour, with the techniques that have come online now, we can do a lot more precise mapping of the brain. And the brain is not that different from one person to the other, but at the same time is very individualistic. Okay? Well, 70 years ago, or 71 years ago, rather 81 years ago, an Austrian scientist by the name of Hans Berger took this experiment that Caton did, and he was able, without drilling holes in the brain this time, because the electronics had become much better, he was able to demonstrate for the first time that as our brain works, it produces electrical currents that we can measure from the outside. We can measure them, in other words, non-invasively. This was electroencephalography. And believe it, 80 years later, it still is a very powerful tool in our hands. I'm trying, for the life of me, to think of other methods and techniques that have withstood